the only video I have produced that doesn't deserve music. Rather, some devilish thunderstorm would be the only fitting thing. You will probably read this summary, but I cannot talk over it again as it causes me pain that I no longer can process and endure. The pain of material and career losses, and also the pain of losing trust and hope for justice in this country that basically tries to convince me that I cannot and should not use my basic right for free speech, which is nonviolent, non-threatening and absolutely accurate speech that I use to explain about the harms that the court-favored vandals have caused me. With my terminal medical degrees and unemployment caused by the endless scamming and defamation by the villains whom I will present a bit later, I opted to earn one more degree to find a job, this time a degree in law, envisioning to become a legislator or judge, not an attorney, as my principles and moral codes would not let me represent the evil and get paid for it. And that's the reason that I deliberately chose the Master in Jurisprudence degree, not JD. I actually presided twice as a judge in D.C. Superior Court and the U.S. Court of Federal Claims, but my overall vision is dead for now, as I do not want to be part of this bogus and primitive circus played by the corrupt courts. From the current brief, you will afford only very, very superficial understanding of what my child and I have undergone. Technically, it is impossible to present all of these issues or cause outcome chains in an offensive war against us that lasts for more than 20 years. Can one write a book or share in a single presentation about the entire World War II, all event casualties or battles? Absolutely not. The publications about that war capture only some fragments. This war is much longer. If World War II lasted only about 6 years, from September of 1939 to May of 1945, this war against me lasts for more than 20 years. Therefore, I can only present fragmented information about it because the harms I have sustained is impossible to measure, and I cannot decide which one to prioritize over another. From where to start? What would you advise me? Which posts of the villains present the first? The ones that were libeling me on the face of the entire global internet at I am bombing the White House, or the ones that were naming me identity thief just because I had changed my legal name to disconnect those stalkers from my way? Or the ones that libeled my precious child and my dead parents, or the barrage of personal insults under my books in Amazon? Imagine that I am applying for a job, my CV is well regarded. I am treated with hope-inspiring hints that it is most likely they will hire me. And after I leave, the potential employer Googles my name or searches it in Bing, and meets horrible posts of libels popping in the first page in the uppermost rows with the highest search index and suggesting that I am bombing the White House. They are opening pages under my full name in the hate sites such as complaints boards, scam groups, scam arrow, and post craziness, and their lengthy defamatory posts are indexed and appear first by the search of my name. Then the same villains are removing all their posts before bringing lawsuits, and even where I have timely saved the screenshot, the judges do not even wish to look at the facts to forensics. In their malicious, smearing lawsuits, the villains do not have a case and instead, they discuss my relationship with my mother, which is none of their business, and benefit from their misportraying of things that they have no clue about. Or should I start from Marina Noble's scammy emails opened under my name and sending obscenity and profanity by those emails to my professional network when I remain unaware of the ongoing for years and observe my friends and colleagues distancing themselves from me? Which one? How many harms shall I present in one case? Shall I start with their contacting my universities to demonize me? Even contacting the faculty at GWU where the father of my child works? Which one comes the first? Or their publishing of scam blogs under my name in WebMD and other sites where they confess on my behalf and without my awareness to having infections that I have never had. This is total chaos. Most of the spectators would have a hard time connecting the dots and finding causality or logic because the offenders themselves are imbeciles, deprived of sound mind and logic. Yes, they are evil but also retards, a rare combination. The only way to put it all together is to write a book of documentaries which will be around 1,000 pages. I am not fully healed. And right now I do not find myself fully committed to writing that lengthy and depressing book. Therefore, to this day, all information about this war is presented in fragmented forms. Even the judges cannot connect the dots, especially when judges do not shine with intelligence. Would they be smart, they would major in physics or mathematics, not in law. This was just one of the hate forums out of thousands that Marina Noble had opened to damage me globally. This one was opened on revistalk.com titled by my name to ensure that this humiliation was popping up with a high index by my name search on Google or Yahoo.com. This forum alone had 27 posts, each placed by Marina Noble using my name to impersonate and ridicule me. She was cursing me with severe obscenity and doing so from the profiles titled with my name. This was opened during my mother's hospitalization and tragic death, and Marina Noble knew about it according to her posts. Thus, even my fresh grief did not stop her from profanity and vicious insults. One of Marina Noble's lengthy and demented posts, which is just a tiny drop out of her volcanic campaign of my character defamation. That hooligan scammer, Marina Noble, had opened this hate forum under my name, so this was popping up with a high search index if anyone in the world would search my name on the internet. Here, she intentionally names a stranger whom I have never seen or met in my lifetime, as if being the father of my child and who, as she claims, has scorned me while talking with Marina Noble on phone. Of course, all is a ridiculous and primitive lie typical to the Discord mastering demon, Marina Noble. Details are explained in this slide. Take time to go over the next overwhelming number of slides with evidence of a clear and undeniable terror against me before we will get to the objective 2 of this video. My red notes and explanations will help you understand the evidence of this everlasting smear and defamation against me. Oh my god. I wonder what kind of internal strength did help me stay alive after all this hurricane of daily smears and defamation by the beast from the underworld, Marina Noble. Imagine a potential employer, suitor, or any random human being googling my name in the period of several years and reading their per se horrible libels popping up on the first page with the highest search index and declaring to the entire world that I am bombing the White House or assaulting to commit murder when none of such idiocy has ever happened. Then, the same beast picks up senile and deaf judges, and her attorney secures a bench hearing with the bribe judge and without a jury trial and wins the case to celebrate the power of digital fraud and falsehood. Then she gets a vague, unspecific order, so she will misinterpret it in the way she wants, which she does it now. Three judges at DeKalb County Superior Court, case 17CV8129, favored my motions disqualifying them and recused themselves to be out of this dirt and illegality. Judge number 4 did not have career anxiety as in 2019 he was almost 80 years old. And so he signed in front of me, in a closed-door bench hearing without a jury trial, a fortune-robbing order pre-written by Marina Noble's attorney Mark Campbell. They wanted capital cash with progressing interest in all properties I hold anywhere in the world. I am not joking, that's really the order was about. Indeed, pursuant to the section 4-104 of the Georgia Code, the state of Georgia does not have a maximum age limit for the state and federal judges like a few other states, Delaware, Idaho, Montana, Nebraska, Nevada, New Mexico. All other states have the mandatory retirement age limit, which is by 70 or 75. Vermont's is 90. 11 days after Georgia Supreme Court denied my writ for certiorari, Marina's crime friend Karine Martirosyan brought another lawsuit. As a coward rat, she did it in her own state, Massachusetts, defaulting the case by an immoral judge and demanding of me a fortune again, with progressing interest. There were weeks that I, a single mom totally distracted from my child and occupied with this petty nonsense, was writing my court papers for 5 cases simultaneously filed against me by these hungry thugs. The aim of this video is to lock important evidence before these diabolic trolls would destroy it, like they always did and do, removing thousands of their posts before bringing lawsuits, in full cooperation with the hate sites that they used against me, among those complaintsboard.com. The 2 core messages of this video are these. First, presenting evidence in a dynamic video format instead of web screens, I strengthen it from preponderance standard to beyond the reasonable doubt standard. In the legal alphabet, the preponderance of the evidence is an evidentiary standard used in the proof analysis, where the burden is met when a reporter convinces that there is a greater than 50% chance that the claim is accurate. Therefore, I am showing the evidence in both picture and video forms. A bit later I will show what I mean. And the second message is that this video is being shared 2 months after the testimony of the only witness of all 6 cases who testified at Middlesex Court, Massachusetts. The virtual hearing by Zoom, which I gladly ignored, took place on September 22, 2021. This video was created on November 22, 2021, 2 months after. Accordingly, this is not an attack on a witness because the so-called witness has already presented his lies and fabrications 2 months ago. Finally, this is that beauty, the clown Terry Lundy, the only witness out of the 6 court cases filed by the same team of the Armenian thugs, testifying against me in a virtual Zoom and hearing held in Massachusetts against an absent Georgia resident. The witness Terry himself is not from Massachusetts, and I argued all that illegality in my notice of appeal. on the first page of which you may see my impeaching of the disqualified witness. To read the entire paper, you can check my slideshare.net documentaries or online legal clinic with Wix.com. Terry Lundy is an ultra-democrat, explicitly hating conservatives and too desperate for attention. So are the opposing attorneys of this case, outspeaking ultra-leftist Trump haters. And I am a moderate conservative. Terry Lundy's web profiles suggest that he is either from Illinois or Virginia. This is his LinkedIn profile. Where he claims of being a certified RCA with worldwide coverage, which shows his delusional mental crisis. I checked the definition of RCA. You can read it too. It is nonsense. So, this crazy witness boasts of being certified in RCA as a qualification to stand as a court expert witness. Most importantly, he claims that he works full-time for a law firm where the attorneys of the opposing party work. This is a crude example of fiduciary trust leverage and conflict of interest because the witness is being paid a regular wage by the law firm that calls him for testimony. All these court cases contributed in my desire to open a comic museum of courts where I will enlarge frame and hang on the museum walls the unhinged and illiterate orders. DeKalb Court in Georgia, where Judge Clarence Seeliger signed an irrational order pre-written by the opposing party who was controlling the judiciary outcomes and signed without even reading it to see that his name was misspelled. Or Georgia Court of Appeals, where even the party's name was misplaced in the case title. There is no such a person as Asnav Matavosian. It had to be Asnav Shahversian, who, by the way, never showed up before the court during the 3 years of the pending case. The court, either intentionally to accommodate Google search results for the favorite party, or accidentally, had applied the opposite party's surname Matavosian to Asnav. Framingham Court, where the same Armenian morons had filed other cases on the same matter, mailed me a notice with already dead clerk's name and without signature. The Framingham Court's clerk John DeLuca had died on August 1, 2020, yet the court was issuing notices in October of 2020, under a dead clerk's authority. This is tragically funny and funly tragic, and deserve an exhibition in a comic museum of courts. A book about all this becomes a fundamental need. Since I recused Judge Michael Doolin from Middlesex County, Massachusetts, not only he refused to recuse himself by reason of his moral unfitness due to his controversial records as a former criminal defense attorney, but he also doubled his immoral and crazy attacks. Go back to check some of his orders in the preceding slides. Thanks for watching. I may share other videos about the ongoing developments.